Hey, I'm Mark.
And I'm Jake from Periphery, and this is For Those About to Rock.
Hey, and welcome to For Those About to Rock. My name is Gilbert Okorn, and I'm here with Periphery. How you guys doing?
Good, man. Yeah.
Thanks for having us.
You're welcome. It's great to have you here. How's the tour been going so far?
Good. It's not been much of a tour. It's like a little mini baby infant toddler tour, because we're only doing today. And then tomorrow at Download Festival. And we did two clinics in London before this. So it's very, very, just a little speck of a tour.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, awesome. Yeah, I just want to talk about the whole clinic. You did two clinics in London a few days ago. And how did that go? What did you guys cover, or what did you guys talk about there?
Lots of nerdy music stuff.
Yeah. We did one at Bell Percussion. I think it was called Bell?
Bell, right? Percussion, yeah.
And then another one at BIM. BIM's a music school. I think Nolly attended BIM in Bristol. But they were really cool. We started out as doing like a band masterclass type thing, and then we did these things called breakout sessions, and we worked with the various musicians that either play guitar, or, you know, there's a guitar group, a drum group, a production group, so it was fun. It was cool.
Yeah, we like to do a lot of sort of educational work in terms of music. We do our own clinics individually, but from time to time we'll get together and do a band clinic, and it's something that personally I really enjoy. I know all the other guys really, really like it as well. It just sort of gives you a different perspective on the music that you perform and that you write when you get to explain it and talk about it and help people just sort of gain some insight, and it helps us learn more about our fans too, which is really cool. So yeah, we love that kind of stuff, man. We do a ton of it.
Okay, awesome. Sounds really awesome. So the next big upcoming thing for you guys is Periphery 3, July 22nd. Really looking forward to that, as I'm sure many other people are as well. Do you guys maybe want to talk about what can the fans expect from Periphery 3?
Just to keep it short and sweet, it's a fun, loud record. We had a lot of fun making it and listening to it. It's just a fun album. It's like the only record that we've done where I'm not sick of it by now, you know?
it's a direct contrast to what we released previously, Juggernaut Alpha and Juggernaut Omega, which is a concept record, and this every song is standalone. There's a little bit of thematic noodling or playing around with, so you might notice some things from other songs, but other than that, every song has its own individual identity, and it sucks. It's terrible. It's worse out there. Just kidding. I love it. But like Mark said, you know, you listen to something enough after you make it, and you're kind of like, oh my God, is anybody even gonna like this? But I still enjoy what we made together.
And the process couldn't be more different than it was for Juggernaut, because with a concept record, there had to be so many little pieces of criteria that the music satisfied, that it was actually pretty painstaking to narrow down what ideas we could and could not use for the album. So with this, we're just like, screw that, let's throw all that criteria out the window and just write music that makes us happy.
Yeah.
And that was super refreshing for us to do together. We got in a room, we wrote it over the course of several weeks together in a retreat style manner. And then we recorded it over, a month and a half or something like that?
Yeah, about a month and a half.
Yeah.
And it was cool because a lot of the album wasn't premeditated. Like, a lot of what we do is normally based on, like, a lot of demos and kind of narrowing down what demos we'd like to pursue to grow into songs. And this, I know for me personally, I can't speak for the rest of the band, but I didn't go in with anything. I kind of just kind of, what I wrote for the album was written then and there, and that was a very, it seemed harrowing at first, but then I realized, hey, I can do this, you know, so.
Writing together is fun.
Yeah.
It's fun.
So you wrote the album more together, or, okay, so everybody in a group, okay, yeah. Awesome. So on Periphery 2, you guys had a lot of features, for example, John Petrucci from Dream Theater, Wes Hodge from The Faceless, and Guthrie Govan from The Aristocrats. Are there going to be any features on Periphery 3?
That's, yeah. You already, I was going to be
sorry,
like, that's a
you're
complicated
play, like, yeah. So we didn't like come to an agreement on what we will say yes and no to.
He spilled the beans.
Yeah, I'm sorry, no. It's just not going to happen, I'm sorry. It's like,
at least guest guitar players. Because, I mean, if you're talking about guest singers, that's a question for Spencer.
Okay.
Understandably so, but for us, it's like, we ran into so many hurdles trying to, like, for instance, the song Have a Blast with Guthrie's solo on it. We love that song, and it's a really fun one to perform live, but I was tasked with playing that solo live.
Okay.
And that sucked, you know? So I couldn't play it exactly how Guthrie played it, so I had to do my own version, which I was okay with. Like, I was happy with it, but of course, then you read YouTube comments and you're like, oh, he couldn't play Guthrie solo. It's like, no shit, I can't play Guthrie solo. Only Guthrie can play Guthrie solo, but I did my own version of it. But no, I think that's kind of a microcosm as to like the bigger issue here. And it's just like, it sucks to play other people's solos.
Yeah, you know? And it takes a long time too, because I know that like all of us have a certain standard for when we're ready to play these songs, we want to put our best foot forward. And it takes songs that do have guest spots on them, like that, like a guitar spot, will take longer to add into a set list, because we won't play them until like that individual feels comfortable playing them. And Mark's been tasked with the Guthrie solo. I play the Jeff Loomis solo on Race Car, and that's like I dread playing that song, and I love that song. Like, I think it's a great song, but once it gets to that part, I'm just like, oh, here we go. I'm just not Jeff Loomis, so this is gonna suck. Mile Zero hasn't made it into the set list yet because of that reason, and Arisaid, also from Periphery II, haven't. And it's just like, we're not going to play these things until we're absolutely ready to do as good as we can, but we'll never nail it. But that's just one of the reasons. And I think, like, once you do that enough, I can't say, I never can say never with these sorts of things. Who knows? Like, who will want to do it in the future, but as of right now, not in this album and not in the foreseeable future.
No.
But now you have a reason, so okay. Yeah. Stop asking. No.
Okay, I understand.
I'm just kidding.
No. Yeah. No, but I really like that, to have, you know, the features in there. But yeah, I can understand it's kind of difficult with the whole sound and tone problems. Yeah. And like song wise, I know I guess you guys don't want to spoil it too much, but the first song you released is kind of heavier. Do you guys have any smoother, more melodic songs on the album, like Arise from Periphery 2 or Priestess off of Juggernaut Alpha?
We have one, and it's probably all of our favorites, right?
Yeah.
So, like, can you say it on three? One, two, three.
Remain Indoors.
Oh, shit, no. That's not the one. I was going to say Loon. That's my favorite. Loon.
Oh, shit, you're right. That is my favorite.
Okay, I guess we have different ones. But both of those satisfy what you just asked. Yeah. Okay.
I didn't know. Like, I was, like, trying to think, all right, what's Mark going to say? What's Mark going to say? Like,
Don't Stop Believing.
Yeah, Loon. Loon is, there's a few on there. There's Catch Fire and Loon. They're, like, I think they're some of our most, like, chillest and accessible songs that we've written. And, that's what I think is weird about the album, because I think we like initially set out to do this like shorter, more like to the point, like album, and then we ended up like kind of running the gamut of the Periphery sound again with like, it's more along the lines of Periphery 1 and Periphery 2 in terms of like each song has its own crazy identity, but the ones that I just mentioned are very very interesting. I'm actually very excited to see what the reaction will be. I mean, I'm sure like all the, you know, the denim jacket kids with the patches all over them are going to be like, what the hell is this shit?
Why all the clean singing?
Yeah, man? What's up with all this clean poppy stuff? Yeah, but yeah, there's a wide, varied sound, but there's a few songs like what you mentioned.
There's a song called Loon that's like, long, like it's like a longer tune, like 7 minutes or something like that, but it's just like this long, patient sort of build up of a song, you know, and that's probably my favorite track on the record, and I would say that's, yeah, a high point for me personally.
Yeah.
Okay, awesome. So when the album hits, do you guys have any plans for upcoming tours in the future, like for fall?
We're doing an open air festival in Chicago. We're doing a summer camp in New York, which falls in line with the education stuff that we were talking about earlier. It's a 3-day summer camp in which we just teach a bunch of students who sign up for the camp, and we all hang out for a weekend up in upstate New York, and we just talk about music and do a bunch of learning. It's awesome. And then we have an August headlining tour in the United States. August, right?
August
yeah. Us headlining 6th, Chon, and Tooth Grinder, an American band, touring with us, so that'll be a good time. And we probably have some fall plans as well. We're playing South Africa in October. And some other stuff planned. Yeah,
I don't think we're going to end it there, but it's just nothing set in stone just yet, so we'll wait to discuss that.
Okay, so yeah, you guys are playing at NOVAROCK today and a Download Festival tomorrow. Do you guys generally prefer festival gigs over venue gigs, or the other way around? Which one do you guys prefer?
For me, it's a completely just different thing. Like, it's a vibe thing completely. Like, you know, I showed up today, and I don't think we've done a festival in a long time. Like, since, like...
It's been a while.
Like, last year, probably. Actually, it's been about a year.
Okay.
Right?
Yeah. I don't know. Yeah. My memory's terrible.
But anyways, that was an American festival. Those were American festivals, and European festivals are pretty different in vibe and quality. You know, when I got here, I'm like, wow, I miss this. I'm, like, sipping wine at, like, 12. You know, just kind of taking everything in. And it has this very, like, grand and epic vibe. And, you know, when you're on tour and you're doing, like, venues and clubs night after night, it doesn't have that epic vibe normally, but it's still cool to know that you're, like, you're on tour, you're going to be doing this for a month, you know, you get into the swing of things, you know, you find where the coffee spot is, you find where you're going to have dinner, you hang out with your friends, you know, you go for a run, whatever it is. And with a festival, it's more about indulgence. You know, like, we walk into our dressing room and, like, the table's covered in booze. And then we get, like, tickets. It's like, you get 3 tickets, breakfast, lunch, and dinner. And it's just like, oh, man, I'm going to be able to pick out here. And I'll be able to pick out here and here. And it's just like, that's the day. And that, you know, it's very different.
This all day, too. You hear that?
Yeah.
That all day, which is cool. You don't get that in a normal club setting, you know? Music all day. That's always fun.
That's always fun. Yeah, we talked to James from Tesseract yesterday, and he was like, festivals are more of a holiday for him than an actual kind of job, you know?
Yeah, that's exactly what I meant. Yeah. That's exactly, he said it better than I did.
You go play for 30 minutes, 40 minutes, and then you, like, barbecue and hang out with your friends and stuff.
And watch some of your favorite bands, maybe.
Exactly, yeah. Exactly. That's also cool. Yeah.
Okay, so Nolly kind of won't be touring with you guys in the future. He's kind of focusing on his own productions. So you're kind of searching for a bass player right now, I'm assuming? Or do you guys already have some people in the back of your head you might hit up?
I think that it's just too early to say right now what we're going to do. We've been discussing it internally, and we feel we're going to take our time with it and not really settle on anything or even, like, publicly discuss what direction we're going in or what we're going to do. It's just kind of like, we have no reason not to take our time and make the right decision for Periphery. So unless you have something,
that's perfectly said. And we're not taking auditions either. Yeah. So sorry for whoever's watching or listening.
Yeah.
No auditions. Sorry.
Yeah. Okay. So what do your musical backgrounds look like? Did you guys already start very young playing guitar, or do you I don't know, or just playing your instruments?
For me, I did start playing guitar pretty young, but I didn't really take it very seriously. I kind of just, like, picked it up. I knew I wanted to play guitar, but I would just kind of, like, mess around with it and pretend like I could play guitar for a really long time. And then around, like, I had lessons and stuff like that. My mom was very supportive of me playing guitar and always made sure I had, like, an amp or a guitar or whatever. But I really didn't start taking it seriously until, like, around 2004, when I really started going to shows and seeing, like, I thought it was so cool that bands, like, lived in vans and, like, slept in Motel 6s and ate, like, Taco Bell all the time. And I'm just like, now that I've done it, I'm like, wow, that sucks. But back then I thought that was really cool, and I wanted to do that and hang out with my friends all the time. And, you know, it's more of what I thought it was than what it wasn't. So I'm happy in that sense. But
I started guitar when I was 13 years old.
Okay.
And I never really thought there was an opportunity to take music seriously. And I think that's what most kids believe, you know. I think that's what we're taught, at least in our country, to believe, which is, like, music is a hobby only. But if you pursue it professionally, you're kind of setting up a trap for yourself, you know. And that's why nobody really encourages their kids to go pursue it professionally, because it's such a crapshoot, so to speak. Luckily we're all able to reach a point where we could say to ourselves, maybe there's a chance we can make it work. Maybe we can actually do this, and we're lucky enough to be here. But yeah, we all started pretty young, I believe, 13 years old.
It came from networking too. Like, I'm from New York. Periphery is based out of Washington, D.C., about 6 hours apart, and there was nobody doing anything I wanted to do in New York. So I had to move to D.C. to join Periphery. So I like, made friends with Misha, the other guitar player, online, and then that's how I met Mark. And Mark had a band. He still has a band. It's just kind of like a new evolution of his band, Haunted Shores.
But we, Hunters and Periphery, used to play shows together, and that's how I met Mark. And then we lost a guitar player, and we needed another one, and Mark wasn't doing the old Hunters anymore. So, like, that's how we all met and got together. And
it's all networking.
That's kind of, you know, I never expected to get any this far when I picked up the guitar at 8, you know? So it's just kind of like the opportunity, like being able to see the opportunity presented was how I got here.
Okay. Well, thanks for the insight on that. So you guys started very young and practiced hard, I guess. So any kind of a topic change, any bands, like in the whole progressive scene, you know, it's hard to find new bands that you really like because it's, you don't get that radio airplay and stuff like that. Any bands you could kind of endorse, or what young bands do you really, really like and want people to keep an eye out for?
Metal bands?
Metal or generally.
I don't want to speak for Mark, but I feel like you're asking a couple of old-timers that, like,
we're
don't...
Old, man.
Yeah, we...
We're old.
I,
Manowar.
What are you talking Pantera. About?
Yeah, definitely keep an eye out for those guys.
Yeah, there's this young band.
That's a good point.
Manowar.
Look, there's something about these older bands that new bands fail to grab the essence from. And maybe we're even one of those bands. I don't know. I can't say that for sure because I'm in the band. But listen to Pantera. Listen to Metallica. Listen to Manowar.
Yeah.
Listen to Black Sabbath.
Saxon.
Like, listen to these bands and try to see what made them great. And you know, incorporate that into your music. Because I feel like a lot of the newer bands only ape other new bands, you know, and they don't really look at the classic stuff. So
and the more I go on and I meet newer, younger bands, the more of them I meet who have never heard Master Puppets or something. Isn't that fucking crazy?
Yeah, that sounds nuts to me.
That should be like a prerequisite. Like,
yeah.
When you reach a certain age, like, you start to get pubes and then you listen to Master Puppets.
Yeah.
You know? It's like, that should be... Can I say pubes?
Yeah, okay,
I took a music appreciation class in college. I know that sounds really weird.
No, I did one too.
Okay, yeah, cool. Yeah, yeah. But they just, you know, they teach you about, like, world music and all the various classical eras. They need to do metal. They need to show the eras of metal that were, you know, influential. Because everybody listened to Metallica. Everybody listened to Pantera. If they haven't, I don't believe them. So
we totally dodged this question. One newer band that we like. 12-Foot Ninja.
Because you're touring with a lot. You're touring a lot, so you have, like, tour supports. Any bands you're really, really fond of?
I listen to electronic music.
Listen to a lot of electronic music.
Yeah, I find it hard to get into new metal.
Okay.
Not new metal, but newer metal.
Spine shank. I like a lot of non-metal bands. Like, 1975 is awesome. They're like a Brit band. There's this, like, new project I've been listening to called Japanese House, which is, like, electro pop kind of stuff. But I mean, I feel like there are bands that we're missing, like Vale of Maya is awesome.
Yeah.
He's wearing their shorts.
Yeah, I'm wearing my Vale of Maya shorts. They're homies.
Who else? Sixth is not young, but they're also cool.
Yeah.
12-Foot Ninja. We already said that. 12-Foot. Carnivool is not young, but they're awesome. They're Australian.
They're amazing.
Yeah, they're incredible.
That's
I feel like we're being such assholes right now.
We are.
Yeah.
Like, hipster.
Oh, everyone sucks.
Jesus.
Jeez.
Just go listen to Pantera now.
Just listen to Pantera. Don't even listen to us. Go buy a Pantera.
Yeah, that's all you need. That's really all you need.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, thanks a lot for that. A lot of our listeners are young musicians themselves. What would be, like, the tips for a young musician? You know, he grabs a guitar, he's been playing for a few years. What would the tip be for him to kind of make it in the whole music industry or music genre, even as a band?
Nothing will be handed to you on a silver platter. Just keep working and keep your expectations tempered and managed and realistic. Because nobody gets into this, nobody should get into this with the expectation of being famous or being on the cover of magazines or being rich, especially.
Yeah.
None of that stuff will ever work out.
Anymore.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
It'll never work out in your favor if that's all you care about. Do it because you love it. And if you do it and you slave away at it and it's still something you hate and you resent doing it, then quit. Don't do it because that's not what life should be about, you know? You should really enjoy it.
And here's an addition to that, because that's perfectly said. but always be on time. And this can apply for anything. Like, don't be late. Like, if you are late, you're going to miss opportunities. If you're late, people are not going to respect you. If you're late, you're not going to be able to play on time because you're playing your notes late. Like, just in all senses of the phrase, be on time. Yeah.
Yes. What about early?
I guess, like, if you're playing early, that kind of sucks.
Sexually?
I don't think you want...
want to be early.
Yeah.
I've been early a couple times.
I think we all have. I mean, sometimes you drink too much, and sometimes you're just with the wrong...
Well, then I'm late.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Yeah, but being on time, punctuality.
Punctuality.
Yeah.
Okay, great. Thank you very much for the tips. Mark? Thank you very much for the interview, Jake. It was wonderful to have you guys. And have a great tour and gig and download tomorrow. Have fun, guys.
Thanks.